May 1798. A massive French invasion force sails across the Mediterranean. 55,000 men, aboard more than 300 ships, escorted by 13 ships of the line. Aboard the most powerful of these, the 120-gun L'Orient, sails General Napoleon Bonaparte. France's celebrated hero of the war in Italy has received new orders from his government. He is to lead an expeditionary force east, to Egypt, the wealthiest province of the Ottoman Empire. And to all educated Europeans, an ancient land of mystery and wonder. After 6 years of war in Europe, the French Republic faces one last remaining enemy: Great Britain. The conquest of Egypt will strike a powerful blow against the British, disrupting their trade in the eastern Mediterranean, and threatening their connections to India and the East. These profitable trade networks help fuel the British war effort. What's more, it will extend France's revolutionary, civilizing mission to the people of Egypt, liberating them from superstition and feudalism. France's corrupt and avaricious government, the Directory, sees two further benefits from the campaign: the opportunity to acquire tremendous riches, and to get the alarmingly popular and ambitious General Bonaparte far away from Paris, where plots and coups are never far from anyone's mind. Napoleon is thrilled by the expedition, which he has done much to promote and organize himself. It is a chance to win fresh glory, and to walk in the footsteps of his heroes, Julius Caesar and Alexander the Great. Like Alexander, Napoleon even has fanciful notions of marching on to India to attack the British there. "Europe is a molehill," he had told his secretary, Bourrienne. "We must set off for the Orient. That is where all the greatest glory has been achieved." But the Mediterranean is dangerous water for the French. While the Republic's armies have won great victories on land, Britain has cemented its status as the dominant naval power of the age, with decisive victories over French allies, the Spanish at Cape St. Vincent, and the Dutch at Camperdown. Rear Admiral Sir Horatio Nelson and his squadron of 14 ships of the line now prowl the Mediterranean. Nelson knows a large French fleet has just left Toulon, but does not know its destination, which remains a closely guarded secret. Undetected, the French expedition sails south along the Italian coast. On the 9th of June, it arrives off Malta. The island is ruled by the Knights of St. John, a religious military order dating back to the Crusades. But the French have decided that they want it for a naval base, and a thorn in the side of the British. In 1565, the Knights had famously held out against a vast Ottoman army for 3 months. Now, despised by the locals, divided amongst themselves, the Knights surrender to Napoleon in just 2 days. During his 6 days in Malta, Napoleon overhauls its archaic government, establishes schools, abolishes slavery, and requisitions money and supplies. Then he sails for Egypt, leaving General Vaubois and a 5,000-strong garrison to hold the island. But where is the Royal Navy? Back in May, Nelson's squadron had been dispersed by gales, He has now regrouped, correctly guessed Napoleon's destination, and is racing to intercept. If he can catch the French, British seamanship and gunnery all but guarantee the destruction of Napoleon's fleet. Then, a lucky break for the French. On the night of the 22nd, Nelson's squadron passes within a few miles of the French fleet. But thanks to heavy fog and darkness, neither side is even aware of the other's presence. The British squadron sails on to Alexandria, where they find no sign of the French. An exasperated Nelson waits 24 hours before heading north to continue his search. Just hours later, the first of Napoleon's ships arrive off Alexandria. Napoleon, aware that British warships are in the area, wants to disembark as quickly as possible. 5,000 French infantry go ashore at night, storm Alexandria the next morning, and quickly overpower its garrison. The rest of the French army lands safely. Napoleon has brought 38,000 troops to Egypt, mostly veterans of the Army of Italy. The five infantry divisions are commanded by generals Bon, Desaix, Kleber, Menou, and Reynier. The single cavalry division is led by the towering figure of Thomas Alexandre Dumas. He is France's first black general, born in what's now Haiti, to a French aristocrat and enslaved African woman. He has already won fame for his actions in Italy, where the Austrians had nicknamed him the Black Devil. There are more familiar faces from Italy. Napoleon's chief of staff, the indefatigable General Berthier. And brigade commanders Generals Murat, Lannes, and Marmont. The army is also accompanied by 167 scientists, scholars, artists, and assorted experts, even a hot air balloonist. Collectively, they are known as the savants, and have come to study Egypt's historical and natural wonders. But they, and Napoleon, find Alexandria a bitter disappointment. The fabled city of antiquity, founded by Alexander himself, has been reduced by centuries of earthquakes and neglect to a ramshackle town of 6,000 inhabitants. Egypt is nominally ruled by the Ottoman Empire. In reality, power lies with local Mamluk warlords. Two in particular, Murad Bey and Ibrahim Bey. Mamluks were originally slave soldiers who once served the Islamic Caliphate. Superb horsemen and fearless warriors, they now rule Egypt with an iron fist, expropriating its wealth and leaving its peasants in poverty. To most Egyptians, they are despised foreign overlords, a situation that Napoleon hopes to exploit with clever propaganda. To the people of Egypt, he proclaims, "I am come to restore your rights and punish usurpers. I reverence God, His Prophet, and the Quran." Meanwhile, Murad and Ibrahim summon Mamluk warlords to the Al-Azhar Mosque in Cairo. Here, they agree to gather an army to crush the invaders. Napoleon believes his best option is to strike quickly. Less than a day after his troops finish landing, he begins his advance on Cairo. But he misjudges the blistering climate and the barren, windswept landscape. He forces the pace, even after his men run out of water and are consumed by thirst. Hundreds collapse and die. A few kill themselves to escape the suffering. Bedouin horsemen circle the French like vultures. Stragglers that fall into their hands are robbed, tortured, and killed. Even old comrades like Lannes and Murat are involved in heated conversations about Napoleon's decision-making. The army takes 4 days to cover the 45 miles to Damanhour, where, mercifully, they're able to rest, drink, and trade for food. It's not a moment too soon. News arrives that a large force of Mamluks under Murad Bey is approaching from the southeast. The French advance to meet them at Shubrahit, on the banks of the Nile. As 4,000 Mamluk horsemen come into view, the French marvel at their brightly coloured outfits, embellished with gold and jewels, and their many ornate weapons, including pistols, swords, daggers, and lances. Murad boasts that he will sever Frenchmen's heads like slicing watermelons in a field. But for all their bravado and panache, the Mamluks have neither the discipline nor tactics to face a trained modern army. When Napoleon forms his troops into giant squares, the Mamluk cavalry can only circle impotently, unable to break through the walls of French bayonets. Scores are shot from the saddle. After 2 hours, the Mamluks call off their attack and retreat. They have suffered around 1,000 casualties. The French have scarcely lost a man. The victory is a much-needed morale boost for Napoleon's men after the hardships of the desert. The Mamluks fall back to Mbebe, a small town on the banks of the Nile, across the river from Cairo. Here, within sight of Egypt's fabled pyramids 9 miles to the south, they will face the invader with their full force. On the sweltering afternoon of the 21st of July, Napoleon's forces approach Mbebe. He has 25,000 men, organized into 5 giant divisional squares, with cavalry and baggage inside, and cannon at every corner. Murad, with characteristic boldness, has crossed to the west bank of the Nile, leaving Ibrahim behind. Their forces total many thousands, but sources disagree wildly on just how many. His elite Mamluk cavalry, 6,000 strong, are deployed between the small village of Biktil and the well-fortified town of Mbebe, which is garrisoned by a mix of Ottoman infantry and peasant militia. Napoleon's plan is simple: to drive through the enemy centre and crush their right flank against the river. At 3:30 p.m, Desaix and Reynier's divisions begin their advance. But as they move across the broken ground, their formation becomes disordered. Murad spots his chance and unleashes his cavalry. The Mamluks thunder forward at lightning speed. Desaix and Reynier react just in time and close ranks. The French hold their fire until the last moment, then unleash a devastating volley. Horses and riders are sent tumbling. The survivors have no way to get to grips with the enemy, who continue pouring deadly fire into their midst. The Mamluks wheel back to regroup, but more charges meet the same result. Many Mamluks simply give up and flee the field. Napoleon orders the divisions of Bon and Vial to move forward. Once more, the Mamluk cavalry charge. Once more, the wave of horsemen shatters on French musketry and bayonets. With the enemy cavalry broken, Bon and Vival's men pour into Mbeba. It is a slaughter. Those who are not killed flee into the Nile, where hundreds drown. Murad Bey escapes with the remnants of his cavalry to Giza, from where he will withdraw to southern Egypt. Ibrahim Bey watches the calamity unfold across the river, then withdraws with his men back to Cairo. It is a crushing, one-sided victory that takes just 2 hours. The Mamluks suffer more than 5,000 casualties, with heavy losses among their elite cavalry and leadership. French losses are less than 300. Napoleon, with his usual flair for PR, decides this great victory will be known as the Battle of the Pyramids, just in sight to the south. On the 24th of July, Napoleon enters Cairo. Parts of the city are abandoned and in ashes after being torched by the Mamluks in their frantic withdrawal. Napoleon observes it would be difficult to find a richer land and a more wretched, ignorant, and brutish people. Nonetheless, Cairo is the heart of Egypt, a city of 600,000 inhabitants, and is in French hands. With the Mamluks scattered and on the run, Napoleon's dream of eastern conquest seems about to be realized. Just 8 days later, the dream is shattered. At sea, Nelson and the British Mediterranean Squadron have not given up their hunt for the French fleet. Finally, on the afternoon of the 1st of August, Nelson finds the French sheltering in Aboukir Bay. With 14 ships of the line against 13, he decides to attack that evening. The British win a complete and stunning victory. The giant French flagship, L'Orient, is destroyed in a massive explosion. By the time it's over, the British have destroyed or captured 11 French ships of the line, and taken more than 3,000 prisoners. With no fleet, Napoleon is stranded in Egypt. What's more, most of his army's cash has gone down with L'Orient. But Napoleon does not despair. If anything, he is invigorated by the crisis. His options are now simple. He and his army must support themselves in this foreign land, or perish. While General Desaix is sent south in pursuit of Murad Bey, Napoleon sets about reforming the administration of Egypt. The old feudal system is abolished. A postal service and hospitals are set up, and a new tax system introduced. Napoleon establishes the Institute of Egypt for scientific and scholarly research. He shows great interest in and respect for Islam, funding the construction of mosques and encouraging the observance of religious festivals. Such engagement later leads to rumours that Napoleon actually converted to Islam. But it is merely a tactic to curry local favour. Napoleon also grapples with news that his wife, Josephine, has resumed her affair with an ex-lover. It is, he's told, common knowledge amongst Paris society. He consoles himself with affairs of his own, including one with an officer's wife. All the while, French efforts to win over the local population are failing. Most Egyptians see only foreign occupiers and infidels. The situation is already at boiling point. Minor revolts break out across the Nile Delta, which are brutally suppressed by the French. Then in September, from Constantinople, Sultan Selim III declares a holy war against the French. Now, the situation in Egypt is about to explode. Cairo, the 21st of October, 1798. General Dupuy, Cairo's military governor, is called out to break up a disturbance. He finds the locals erecting barricades, is set upon and killed. Soon the whole city is up in arms. The French fight back with ruthless discipline and crush the revolt. Some 300 French soldiers are killed, alongside several thousand Egyptians. Napoleon ostentatiously pardons the ringleaders, while quietly telling Berthier that every rioter caught with a weapon is to be beheaded and thrown into the Nile. The French have bloodily reasserted control in Cairo. But it is clear, Napoleon will never win the hearts and minds of the Egyptians. The next few months see the French languish in Cairo. There is limited communication with France, much homesickness, and a dwindling supply of stores, ammunition, and wine. There is also an outbreak of bubonic plague, which torments the army and further thins its ranks. The only action is in the south, where General Desaix's column, 2,800 men, pursue Murad Bey deep into Upper Egypt. In this epic chase, one officer distinguishes himself. A 28-year-old cavalry brigadier named Louis-Nicolas Davout. On the 22nd of January 1799, he and Desaix inflict a serious defeat on Murad Bey, scattering his remaining forces. Murad himself escapes and remains at large. But such military victories do little to change the outlook for Napoleon's expedition. They remain 1,600 miles from France, with no prospect of reinforcements or getting home. Napoleon briefly puts his hopes on a diplomatic solution. France's foreign minister, the brilliant, urbane and slippery Charles Maurice de Talleyrand, had been an early supporter of the Egyptian expedition. He's assured Napoleon that he will personally travel to Constantinople to smooth relations with the Sultan and win Egypt for France. But Talleyrand never leaves Paris. The Sultan remains furious at France's attack on his Egyptian province. There is to be no negotiation and no compromise. Orders have gone out to every corner of the Ottoman Empire to raise troops to drive out the French invader. Napoleon's position looks more desperate than it's ever been. His troops cut off, disease-ridden, in the midst of a hostile population. He will respond in the way that seems obvious to him, as it would to his hero Alexander. He will attack. One of the most important skills for any historian is to be able to critically evaluate sources of information. Who's sharing it? Why? And what's their bias? Napoleon himself, for example, was a notoriously unreliable narrator of his own life. Today, we need these critical skills just to navigate the media landscape. Take the war in Ukraine. Anyone following the conflict knows that information varies from reliable to biased to outright fabrication. But which is which? Now there's a website and app that helps you to understand where your news is coming from. Ground News, our video sponsor, is a website and app on a mission to give readers an easy, data-driven, objective way to read the news. They don't just aggregate the news from multiple sources. Every story comes with a quick visual breakdown of the political bias, factuality, and ownership of the sources reporting it. For example, here's a story on Zelensky's trip to Washington. Right away, you can see that 101 news outlets reported on the story. Of these, 24% are left-leaning, 16% are right-leaning. You can even see who owns the outlets reporting on the story, and that 63% are owned by media conglomerates. Ground News also makes it easy to compare headlines, so you can see how political bias and ownership can affect framing. For example, on the right you have one news outlet saying, "Aid prospects are bleak," and another saying, "Last-ditch plea." Then on the left, you have another outlet saying Zelensky is fighting for aid, and trying to break deadlock in Congress. We can then go on to read the full article, all within the Ground News app. Another feature we love is their Blind Spot feed, which shows you stories that are being underreported by both the left and right. Put another way, if you mostly read left or right-leaning media, which stories are algorithms and media bias keeping off your radar? Ground News is fantastic for staying up to date with the news, while crucially remaining fully aware of who's serving you the story. It's the perfect way to smash down the walls of the echo chamber and get the news from multiple perspectives. We have no hesitation in recommending this app to our viewers, and right now is the perfect time to try it out. With their holiday sale, you'll get 40% off their Vantage plan, which gives you unlimited access to all their features. This offer is only available by going to ground.news/epichistory, or clicking the link in the video description. It's their biggest sale of the year, so sign up today and help an independent platform working to make the media landscape more transparent. Thank you to all our Patreon supporters who make this channel possible. Find out how you too can get ad-free early access to all our videos, as well as various other perks, by visiting the Epic History TV Patreon page.